The apostle Paul. Paul said he pressed towards the mark of a higher call in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You must understand that the enemy ain't gonna just let you get up and walk out. You got to press your way out of here. Hey, hallelujah to God. I greet you all in Jesus' name. The hour of prophecy. The hour of prophecy has come upon us. Amen. It's time to hear what God is saying to the house of bread. Let us go right into prayer. I greet you all in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth remain silent before him. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Eternal Father, gracious Lord, the Lord, the God of all flesh, we say thank you for giving us the spirit to press through. Hallelujah. We thank you for giving us the spirit of discernment to know what God is pleased with. We thank you for your disciplinarying spirit, that when we are out of order, we have a God that will put us back into order. And I thank you for it in the name of Jesus. Now, Master, I bind Satan right now. I come against Jezebel right now. I come against Beelzebub right now. I bind every witch. Hey, Kashata, I bind every warlock. I cast down every root worker in the name of Jesus. And I bind them all and cast them all down back to hell from where they come from. In the name of Jesus. Now, Master, remember your manservant on today. Anoint these lips of clay. Make the tongue like the pen of the ready writer. And I bless your holy name for it. Now, Master, send your word. Lord God, send your word. Lord God, send your anointing. Master, send your anointing in the name of Jesus. Now, Master, have your way in this place. Hallelujah to God. Lord God, command the angels to trouble the water in the name of Jesus. And I bless your holy name for it. Now, Lord God, not my will be done, but let thine will be done as it is in heaven. As it is, let it be done on earth. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Let the Redeemer of the Lord say amen. And it is so. Hallelujah. My text is coming from Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. I'll be reading from 12 to 16. And I sincerely solicit your prayers. Amen. Amen. 4 and 12. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joint and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart. The word of God cuts down to the marrow, a discerner of the intent of your heart. Huh? The Bible says that man looks at the outer appearance of a man, but God looks at a man's heart. That's what kept David going. The Bible said David was a man after God's own heart. Oh, I come to preach. I come to preach. Amen. Hallelujah to God. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. And you ain't did nothing in that back room. In that basement, in the cellar. It depends on what part of the world you live in. Some people call it a basement. Some call it a cellar or up in the attic. I heard of it. He said, ain't nothing hid from him, no creature. And you have to give an account to him. And you got, hey, bullshit. The Bible says every man got to give an account on the day of judgment. Praise the Lord. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Tara bullshit. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open. All things are naked. You naked to God. Somebody say, preach, Bishop. That grace is alive. And someone say amen. Somebody say amen. Naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. I ain't gonna get over that. In verse 14, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. I'm going to 16, verse 15. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points our weakness, but in all points tempted as we are yet without sin. Jesus was tempted, but he didn't sin. He said, hey, double shout out. So we got a high priest. Did you hear what he said? Hey, that can sympathize. I mean, he has compassion. Thank you, Jesus. And 16, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Praise the Lord. Saints of God, my text is under the influence. So my head, Busha, Bakaba, under the influence. My friends here, Paul is making a dynamic statement about being tempted and tested and tried and pressing his way through and He's saying that we have a God who is a high priest, that he can sympathize with our weaknesses, a man who that was even tempted himself, but tempted not with sin, amen. Understanding that we know that if God has put in our mindset, he has also put it in our spirit. Therefore, we must understand what the bishop is saying today under the influence. I fully understand being under the influence of something. When a person is under the influence, my brothers and my sisters, they are being dominated by whatever influences them. You don't hear me? Hallelujah to God. When a person is strung out on drugs, narcotics, that drug is there dominant. It dominates you, because you can't tell me that a man can be under the influence of something and yet be concentrating on something totally different. That's impossible. Man don't have the ability to split himself open. When you are under the influence of something, you are walking according to the precepts of that thing. In other words, you learn the characteristics of it. Now, you don't hear me? But when I come by the house of bread, when you see the bishop coming, he's under the influence of the Holy Ghost, because I come to do the will of God. I've got a different type of attitude because I know that God is with me no matter what. I come to tell the house of bread under the influence. Paul says, let us come boldly to the throne of grace. In other words, when you're doing your dirty work out there, when you're doing your dirty deeds, you're doing it boldly, my brothers and sisters. Don't come before God with a temper that is timid. Do not act like you shy and shame. You don't do that when you're doing the devil's work. I come to tell somebody, I've been under the influence so long that it becomes normality. When you begin to look at what you have been influenced by, you see that it's all meaningless. Solomon said it's like a chase in the wind. It's all meaningless. He said it makes no sense whatsoever. He says he built palaces. He had trees from Lebanon, the great tent center of Lebanon, to come to him to make him palaces. He said he planted vineyards. He had irrigations dug to water the vineyard. He said he had a harem of women, multiple wives. Hallelujah to God. He drank the finest wine. He said he traveled the world seeking for this thing called satisfaction. And he said it's all meaningless. He said it is vanity. Hey, it's vanity in order to be searching for something that ain't going to satisfy you. The Bible declares the only satisfaction is in Jesus. When you're under the influence, you understand that God has already bought you through some things. When you're under the influence, you're being a groom for another purpose in your life. God is beginning to take you to another level in him. When you're under the influence of Jesus Christ is a peaceful thing. It's very powerful. And the Bible says it's sharper than any two-edged sword, the word of God. When Paul writes in Ephesians, hallelujah, chapter 6, when he says put in 10, he said put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand in the evil times. When he begins to minister about putting on the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, shun your feet with shoes, he said, and taking the sword, which is the word of God. Somebody shout hallelujah. When you're under the influence, then therefore you're no longer concerned about worldly things. And somebody said that the Bible teaches, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. When your mind is renewed, you have just come under the influence of something. Tarabu, tarabu, yirabashata. Baba, hallelujah. Let's look in Ephesians. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I feel my help all over me now. Let's look in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. Praise the Lord. Somebody say, work on me, Bishop. Work on me, Bishop. Chapter 2, verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love for love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. Verse 6, and raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ. Verse 7, that in the age to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. I'm going to 10, my friends. Verse 8, for by grace you have been saved. That's twice he said that. He said it, and he said it in 8, and he said it in 6. He said, by grace we have been saved. See, God's grace, unmerited favor. We can't earn it. We can't buy it. Amen. You can't go, you can't be a Rhodes Scholar and go to Oxford and get no grace. It's a gift from God, and God chooses who he give grace to. You don't hear me? Hallelujah to God. You under the influence. You're under the influence. Amen. Verse 8, he says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God. Go ahead, prophet. I hear the prophet. The prophet is, our prophecy is all over the bishop. And it's a gift of God. Amen. Ain't no man. You can't, Amazon can't bring that to your door. I'm trying to help somebody here. I know you believe that, Amazon, because, QVC and all that. Somebody say, I know you up late at night looking at QVC and HSN and, you know, and WBN, and come on, somebody. But this thing right here, you can't hide from it. It's look at, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah to God. Where am I at now? It says, it is the gift of God. Amen. And verse 9, not of works, least anyone should, but not of works. You can't work and get grace. And you can't do nothing. See, you can't influence God with your works. You finite. You sinful man. We all got sin. Huh? Somebody said you can't influence him. So the Bible says not works, lest any man shall boast. Because if you could work your way into heaven, somebody said you'd be bragging. Oh, I just did it. Oh, I done worked my way in. You see, it ain't like that. It ain't like that. You can't work your way. Hey, good. You can work on some things, but you can't work on this. And that was verse 9. Verse 10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good work, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. We are his handiwork. I've told you before about seeing the hand of God. Hey, man, you can see the mighty hand of God in nature. You can see it in the squirrels, in the birds. Hey, man, you can go, hey, man, down to the river or to the beach and get a fish. You want to see something awkward? Take a fish and lay him up on the pier and watch him. Watch him. Huh? Gasping for air. But when you put him in that water, look at his skillfulness. Hey, look at that emotion. See, when watch him move, because he's under the influence. When you're under the influence, you're no longer walking by your own power. You're under the power of whatever influences you. When I come to tell the house of bread, that in order to be under the influence of God, you got to get this word in you. The Bible declares that the only thing that will save a man is the word of God. Amen, that will break every yoke of the enemy, that will edify you, that will separate you. The Bible talks about sanctification, being sanctified. The Bible says that every believer is sanctified. Sanctified ain't about hitting the tambourines and running around the church. That is a facet of it. That is a denomination that worship God that way. But what the Bible speaks when he's talking about sanctified, he means being set apart, separated from the worldly things, separated for the good work of God. That's to me. And sanctified, every man that's going to heaven must be sanctified. You can't get in there. But somebody say, I'm under the influence. And then when I look here at what Paul is saying in Ephesians, he's telling them that God now understands your condition. Somebody say, it's not my condition, but my position. I'm not in a condition that can't be made well. As the woman with the issue of blood, the Bible said, 12 long years, she was having an issue of blood. But when she saw the prophet Jesus, She said, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I could be made whole. Well, I come to tell you, when you get under the influence of Jesus, you become made whole. Though you break, God deals in broken things. I come to tell the house of bread that no weapons formed against you shall prosper. And every word that spoke against you in judgment, my God shall condemn, because you are under the influence of the Holy One. The Bible says he's a high priest. We say, hey, that sits high and look low. His eyes is everywhere. I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. David said he lifted me up out of a horrible pit, out of the murky clay, put my feet upon a rock and established my going, put a song in my heart. And I'm so glad about it, because if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I would have been dead sleeping in my grave. But thanks be to God for such a time as this. He said the hour of prophecy. Prophesy to your house, Bishop. I prophesy to the house of bread. God said, get ready, get ready, get ready. Your hour has come. Arise. You know what he told Joshua? He told Joshua to get up. Your hour has come. As I look in my clothes here, as I look in my clothes, thank you, Holy God, I feel the power of the Holy Ghost. I feel the Holy Ghost moving right now. I feel him moving in Jesus' name. Oh, God, help me. In my clothes, in Ephesians, in Hebrews, stay with me, 13, 12. Pick it up at 12, Bishop. Where is it at? Help me, Holy Ghost. I might be going backwards here. The devil is a lie. Somebody say, I might be in the wrong book. I'm in two. I need to get in Hebrews. I'm in Ephesians. See, somebody say, hey, good God, I know. Hey, so see, it didn't feel right. You understand what I'm saying? It's an unction. The Bible talks about unction. You know what an unction is. My grandmother, right? Watch this. If you sit beside her out in a public place, watch this. She sees something out of ordinary, you know what she'll do? Punch me. Huh? Right there in the side. And she don't bruise her hand, she do her head. So I look at it. That's an unction. The Holy Ghost just hunched me. It didn't feel right. It won't right. I'm in Ephesians talking about Hebrews. Praise the Lord. Because see, when I get under the anointing, I get blind. That's why sometimes it's hard for me to find my scripture. Because I'm not in the natural, my brothers and sisters. I'm in the spirit realm. And hey, good God of mine. But the Holy Ghost, he said, look. That ain't Hebrews, Bishop. I know you know the book of Hebrew from Ephesians, but I was trying to get it, Warner, because I'm under the influence. I'm under that wine. I'm under that emotion. And when you're under the influence, you don't do what you do when you're not. That's another message. That's another message. Have you ever seen a drunk man, huh? Cuss out everybody, can't stand up, huh? What I'm saying is, when you're under the influence, you don't do the things you do when you sober, natural, huh? If there's such a thing, ain't nobody really natural, you know. So, cause see, the Bible says if a man think about something, wait a minute. Thank you, Holy Ghost. He quickened me. Solomon put it like this. He said, if a man look at a woman and think sexually, just looking at her and thinking, he's already committed the sin. He ain't got to touch her. It ain't got to be physical. If it's in your thought, in your mind. That's why I pray, ask God to sprinkle my thoughts with his blood. Huh? So I ain't thinking wicked like that. Because the Bible makes it plain. You ain't got to do physical sin to be sin. You can sit up and plot sin, thinking about letting it in your spirit, man, letting it in your eye gates, in your ear gates. When you do that, you've already committed sin. That's what the Bible teaches. Now, you got something better? Somebody say amen. In other words, it's a thought before it's a thing. I don't care what it is. It's a thought before it's a thing. Before a man gets up and do something, he first got to think about it. I ain't talking about he got to, wait a minute, where can I sit up shop at? He ain't got to, let me see. He ain't got to sit here for 20 minutes, huh? When it just runs, somebody say, it just ran through my mind. You already sinned. That's what the Bible teaches. And I don't know about you, But that's the only thing I want to know. I don't want to know about what you got to say. Somebody say, in the book of Hebrews, in my clothes, good God Almighty, help the bishop. In Hebrews 13, 12. Hebrews 13 and 12. I'm still in John. I must be on fire right now. I can't even find my scripture. Okay, in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 12 to 17. And 12 says, therefore, Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gate. Sanctify the people. Blood washed. Sanctify them. Set them apart. Separate them for the good work. That's sanctification with his blood. Therefore, let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his approach. For here we have no continuing city, but we seek the one to come. 17 is where I'm stopping at. Only those who rule over you. No, obey those. Boy, I must be high. I must be under the influence. I mean, I can hear that boat. That's all right. Huh? You know what I'm doing? I'm pressing my way through. I'm pressing. That's what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. And Holy Ghost will quicken me and say, no, that ain't what it says. It says obey, Bishop. See, I don't know about you, but I got help in the camp. Obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who give an account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you. You under the influence. It says, obey those that, amen, that watch out over you. Obey your pastors. Obey your man of God, the one that ministers to you, because they give an account to you. They pray to God for you. They go intercessory to God about your affairs, even though they don't have to know. They say, God, forgive them. Hallelujah to God, because when you're under the influence, all things is possible. The Bible writes in Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. I can move mountains if I just have the faith the size of a mustard seed. But I come to tell the house of bread that under the influence means that you're walking in a newness day, that you're not walking in the world any longer, that you've got a made-up mind to serve this Jesus. You've got a made-up mind to walk on it and talk it, because you know who he is by your confession. He is my God, and I'm so glad because I'm now under the influence. Somebody shout, under the influence. Shall prosper. It won't work. A weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work. God will do what he said he would do. He will stand by his word. He will come through. Oh, under the influence from the house of bread. From the house of bread. No weapon formed, because you're under the influence. Hey, you're under the influence. Wave the flag. I surrender to Jesus. I surrender all. I surrender. Hallelujah. I'm under the influence. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.